Call this meeting of Ojai County Fiscal Court to order this 28th day of November, 2017, at 5 p.m. I'm going to ask David Randolph to come forward and lead us in a prayer and pledge the flag.
Sure, I'll pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for our lives, our health, our strength. We ask you, Lord, that you come into this meeting today. And we ask, Lord, that your will be done and that whatever we say or do, that we put you first and that our lives will be a light to shine that people can see that in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you,
Dave.
You have before you the minutes of the November 14th meeting, and I'd ask for a motion to approve.
Make a motion.
Motion by Joe Barnes.
Second.
Second by Jason Bullock. Is there any questions, additions, or corrections? Being none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Motion carries. Before you, you have in red the bills, claims, payments, and transfers, including a brief late list.
Oh, let me do it. Yeah, I didn't see the late list. I'm sorry.
Motion to approve.
Nobody made one.
No. Motion by Larry Cam.
Also.
Second by Jason Bullock.
We got the money on here for this potto pantry. Did we end up going ahead and getting that?
We voted to purchase it upon inspection.
Yeah.
But they needed to take a little bit with them in order to walk away with it, so.
Yeah, they can take the check, but they will bring the check back if they don't buy the potto. It's upon inspection.
We haven't gone and inspected it.
No.
Okay. When are we expecting to go?
Friday.
Okay.
Any other questions if not, are any other discussion? If not, roll call.
Barnes?
Yes.
Johnson?
Yes.
Camp?
Yes.
Small?
Yes.
Bullock?
Yes. That motion carries. Now, we're going straight into the Career Center update. David Randolph's going to give it to us. Sheila's coming up with him, and Kenny's here for backup for him, and he's going to give the presentation, and then all three of them can answer questions if you have
them. All right, good evening. Thanks for having me here. You all are my witness. When I tell my family that I led the prayer, they're going to faint. Bear witness if you're asked that. But
which one are you?
No, he doesn't have those.
Oh, okay. That's yours. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. First, I want to give you the Kentucky Career Center hours. We are now open from 7:30 a.m. Monday through Thursday. We close at 5 p.m. And on Fridays, we're open from 8 to 12. We extended the hours so that when people who are working manufacturing, if they're wanting to update a resume or do something like that, that gives them time to come to the Career Center and perform those tasks. Always we want to keep up with the unemployment rate, and I gather my statistics from the Bureau of Labor Statistics, the Southeast region out of Atlanta, Georgia. And right now, the unemployment rate for Kentucky is 4.3%. Ojai County, the unemployment rate is at 5.3%. So that's down a little bit, but I like to stay on top of what the other counties are doing and what their unemployment rates are. Butler County's is at 4.9%. And, you know, we service Butler County with ARC, Casco, Quarterback, and Delta Faucet. We provide a service for them as far as distributing applications and things of that nature. Davis County is at 3.9%. McLean County is 4.8%. Hopkins County is 4.2%. We're starting to get a lot of action coming from Hopkins County, and that's mainly because their career center is closed there. So the nearest center that they have to report to is Paducah. So we are starting to get a lot of traffic coming from Hopkins County. Muhlenberg is 5.6, and Hancock County is at 4.4. Now, Hancock County is number one in the state always as far as salaries and things of that nature, basically because of the aluminum plants that they have up there. On average, their weekly salaries range over $1,300 per week, and that's net pay. The Career Center also provides weekly job fairs. Purdue comes, Dicel, and People Plus are regulars there, and anyone else who wants to come and have a job fair, we have an office available for them. Also, we're pleased to have Ed Williams back. He is our new Veterans Administration representative. And as you may well know, Ed is a very dedicated person. He's a retired postman, but he is with the DAV of veterans, and he volunteers his services for free. And as a result of that, we get a lot of traffic now. He's there weekly, whereas when Johnny Allen was there, it was once per month. And Johnny did a good job, but Ed has the time to be there weekly. He even goes out, which is impressive. If a veteran is in-house and can't get out, he will go make a home visit. So it is an asset here to the county to have Ed with us. Also, the Career Center sees on average about 25 people daily, over 6,200, somewhere in that category per year. We focus a lot on soft skills, and Kenny and I have been talking about programs that we're going to try to implement. An article came out in 2000 in February of this year, and one of the main reasons that people don't get jobs even here in the county is lack of soft skills, and you would be surprised. People just don't have them, and hopefully the Career Center will be able to get some materials and things in like that so that we can offer that. We still provide the electronic board for events and things like that. You'll see a lot of Veterans Administrations advertising and things like that on there. We've purchased a new Kentucky flag and American flag to go in the Career Center. We have two monitors in for security reasons. So one is up front and one is in the computer room. One of the big factors that's really an asset at all companies are going to is the Workies test. And we've been working diligently with Mr. Autry on the Workies test. It is no longer a paperback issue. Everything is online now. So the client is able to go in, work at their own speed. Well, there's a time limit on the computer, but instead of those scores having to be taken to Warrensboro and brought back within a matter of minutes, they can get their score right there printed, and it can go out to the employer. We also have the Job Corps still coming to the Career Center, and they are getting active in the county as another avenue for a kid who may, it's not necessarily lost their way, but a lot of times the Job Corps gets a bad rep because it's viewed as a program for troubled teens, and that's just the opposite. Kids can live here in the county and travel to the local facility every day and train for electrician, construction, anything like that, and we're trying to get other companies to get involved to offer programs to these people. So there's just a plethora of things that's going on at the Career Center, and I could be up here all night, but I know y'all don't want that. But if anytime you have any questions or anything, feel free to stop in, and we're there for you.
You said your hours were Monday through Thursday, 7:30 to 5?
Yes, sir.
8 to 12 on Friday?
That is correct.
David, how much trouble or how complicated it would be for you guys to be able to give the GED test? Does that involve a lot?
Well,
we could have that here in the county instead of people driving on school.
I don't think it would be that big of an issue.
It's already here. I mean, Del Ted down here gives it.
It's one stop.
They don't give the test over there.
No, they travel. No, they travel to Warrensboro. I don't think it would be, sir. I really don't see why they have to travel to Warrensboro. I just talked to Amy Leach about that the other day, because we're a one-stop center now, and we work in concert with, you know, the adult ed and everybody. We're under one roof now, and we are a full-fledged career center. So I don't see why the exams can't be given over here. We got to get our numbers up.
Is it something to do with the Kentucky, you know, how they're not really wanting to have career centers throughout they want the regional ones. Is that what it is?
I don't think that's the case here. I just think
you probably sometimes have to be, don't you probably have to go be trained to give the test, and that's what, like the work keys, did you have to go do some training? Because at one time,
we couldn't give
work keys because we didn't have a trained person to give it.
Right, but we have a trainer now for the work keys, okay. And Sheila has been trained, and Kenny and I have sat in on it. I'm going to go and do the training also. But to answer your question, I just asked the same question the other day. Why do they have to travel? Because in my view, if someone has reached that level to graduate, and let me tell you, going through that program, if a kid had to go through a GED program, they would stay in school. It's not easy. So when they have a graduation and someone from this county obtains a GED, I think it should stay here in the county so they can be recognized.
Would you care to check into that for us and get back to the report?
I wouldn't care at all.
It is totally different than the Career Center, Larry. It's under OCTC, yeah. Skill train, their regulations, laws, whatever, different than the Career Center. So we can't get involved in testing for GED. I know that because they do. That office does that. We refer to them, but I didn't know that the test had to be given in. I know they do all the training here.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
I do know the testing and the graduation is always in Owensboro.
Yeah.
And that
skill training, I guess.
Yeah, but I don't know why, but I will. It doesn't hurt to ask, and sure. I will get back with you all on that. Okay.
Really appreciate that.
Yes, sir. You have any other questions? All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dave. Y'all doing a great job.
Thank you.
Justin was going to talk a little bit about the museum agreement, but he said he'd rather just give it to you. He's emailed it to everybody. If you have questions, call him. And we'll talk about it the next meeting.
Yeah, just email me. It's fairly lengthy, so I wanted to give you an opportunity to look at it. at the next meeting, we can decide what you want to do.
So this is the copy right here?
Yeah.
And we'll have a closed session just before Justin presents that to you. If that's okay under the closed session rules. Next, we have the SEDS 2017 report. We have these folks here all going to present that to you and tell you what that SEDS report tells us. And first, tell them what that means, what it stands for.
The SEDS is the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy. It's something that GRAD, as a seven-county region, has to do every 5 years for the Economic Development Administration, the federal administration. And like I said, it's done every 5 years, and it's basically just sort of a benchmark of where we came from, where we are, and where we want to go. I'll spotlight some of our strengths and weaknesses that were outlined in the analysis and the strategy, and then Kenny will go over some workforce information. Some of the strengths that were identified for the region are a strong transportation network, our low energy costs, and our higher education options within a short drive. Some of the weaknesses were our low post-secondary degree attainment, which Kenny will go into, and little entrepreneurship. Opportunities, development of I-69, I-65 spurs, which will definitely be beneficial to the region, and threats. Decreasing or the threat of potential decreasing coal severance dollars, lack of internet and cell service, and poor health, which Kenny will also go into. And just to give you all some statistics on where we stack up as a county against the region, one of our weaknesses is also our lack of diversity in the region. They go into our racial composition in the region. Union County only has 83% white. McLean County has the highest white population at 96.5. Ohio County is pretty up there close with McLean County. But the white populations have been decreasing over the years. The African American population has held pretty steady, but we've seen a drastic increase in the Latino and Hispanic residents, with populations doubling and in some cases tripling since the last report. So that's a good thing. As far as some of our objectives and what we're doing here in Ohio County specifically, like I said, one of the weaknesses is our lack of internet and cell service. You all have heard me talk about our efforts to upgrade those in some of my quarterly reports. The advent of Kentucky Wired, and albeit, you know, it's behind schedule, but that is drastically going to improve the county and the region as far as our internet connectivity and cell service with AT&T launching their fixed wireless service. In the county, that should serve most of our residents with cell service. As far as entrepreneurship, you know, you've got the hub across the street as a prime example of us trying to spur people launching their own businesses and doing work that can be done remotely as an independent contractor. Our efforts with tourism, I think Jody has reported before, but our tourism revenue in the county alone between 2015 and 2016 grew by $1 million. And tourism is the second largest industry in the state of Kentucky behind auto manufacturing. So it's nothing to be discredited or discounted. And our efforts to boost tourism in Ohio County are serious efforts. Joe and Pastor Morphew sit on the Bill Monroe Foundation with me, and they know, you know, the efforts we've taken to increase tourism up there at the home place. We have the Bill Monroe Museum, which is a project that you all have financed the initial construction costs of, that we hope to have open next summer, that will help build make us into more of a bluegrass music region, coupled with the museum that's being built in Owensboro and the Hall of Fame up there. So those are all positives, and they also spotlighted our efforts to construct the river access points on Rough River for canoes and kayaks. That's another significant effort that we got some help with the Recreational Trails Grant. And like I told you in the last quarterly report, we'll be launching that construction next spring. In general, just some statistics they offer, which I also gave you all a copy of some of the key points that I pulled out, not at this meeting, a couple meetings prior when I had to leave for a football game, but this was also one of the handouts that I gave you. Our cost of living and cost of doing business in Kentucky are very good. We ranked second in the nation for cost of living, but for quality of life, we ranked 42nd. For our workforce, we ranked 46th. Access to capital, 38. So, I mean, those aren't necessarily things to be proud of, but that's why we're working on the things that we're working on and stressing our workforce development and workforce innovation efforts so heavily. And with that, I'll turn it over to Kenny and let him spotlight some of the things that we're doing there that are mentioned in the strategy.
Okay, thank you. I hand you out some of my scribbles there, something I wrote down today, out of the SEDS report. Now you can get this total report by going on the grad website, or it's in the office, so you can get a copy there. It's thick, it's probably 60, 70 pages, a lot of charts and information. So we've tried to highlight what we felt were some of the most important things in there. As I say there at the beginning, it's 7 counties in this area that make up the Green River District. So what we're talking about here is stats from those 7 counties, and then we specify by county in a lot of cases. We get a report every 5 years. The last few SEDS had shown slow changes in the grad region, which is good in some cases and bad in the others. We get a bust like 208, 209 in the U.S. We don't get the bust as bad here. But at the same time, if we boom across the country, we don't see a big boom like we do in some areas. Our population in grad has changed about 21.5% since 1970, so say 47 years. Ohio County has grown about 28% in those 47 years, but Kentucky has grown 53 point something, U.S. has grown 55, so we're approximately half of the growth that the U.S. on average and Kentucky on average. So slow growth in this region. For whatever reason, and I could have said, Chase may have said, we're an agricultural region primarily, even though we have more manufacturing. We are, every county except Hancock, agriculture is the leading economic thing going there. Medium income growth in grad has been, let's see, Ohio County from 2000 to 2015, they've grown 35.9%. Our medium income 2015 was 40,000 versus 29.5 in 2000. This is second region. And they, surprisingly, when you look, you see the Ohio County's medium income has grown. Next to Hancock County, Hancock is a little bit ahead. And if you look at the growth since 2010 to 2015, it's 11.4%, which again places us slightly behind Hancock County. What we have seen since 2000 is manufacturing increase in our county by about 40%. We've seen farm employment drop 18.6%, construction drop about 19.8%, so around 20. I had time to apply maybe, some of that pretty self-explanatory. We'll go into the health issues a little bit here. So this is very important. In Ohio County, adult smoking and excessive drinking are about average with the rest of grad, above average with the national on smoking especially, 9 points above the U.S. when it comes to adult smoking at 24%. Drinking at 11%, that's excessive with adult excessive drinking, 11%, and that's minus 1% of the rest of the grad counties. the two areas that they have that are very negative is adult obesity, which we show at 40%. That's about a +5 for the average of Kentucky, the rest of Kentucky. And to go along with that, we have physical inactivity. So obesity plus, they go together, you know, physical inactivity at 34% of our people. And that's about 5 to 9% above the other red counties. So, you know, you can figure these two together lead us to more than average cases of heart disease, diabetes, leading to lower life expectancy. So, something serious that is being looked into. Educational attainment, very important to our county, and I'm going to leave that grad stats now and go to our work-ready communities. The other sheet I gave you. Now back in September, the work-ready community committee sent in an application for an extension, a recertification update. The reason we were sending in an extension for a request for a continuance of this work-ready communities in progress. If you look at the criteria on the first page. 3 years ago, when we became a work-ready community in progress county, we had 3 years to make improvements in these areas. And as we go down through here, you can see we've high school graduation rate was great. That has improved above what was required. I want to skip educational attainment for now and come back. Number of working adults without a high school diploma or GED, you see that's went from 21% down to 17.5.
And Kenny, if I may interrupt, that's what I was speaking of earlier. Make it advantageous to the people here in the county, and that might bring that figure down.
Right, that's one of the things we're graded on, is how we're doing with decreasing the number.
Okay, and, thanks.
Broadband, according to the figures we get from the state, 100% of our people can get broadband. We know that's an awful weak broadband problem, but anyway, we're okay on that criteria. The National Career Readiness Certificate, that's ACT Work Keys test we give. We have one from 1.3% up to 9.56%, and that's, you know, that's great. We had 185 people 3 years ago. Now we've got 1,360 that are certified in this county with the work keys.
Where does that point need to be? Where do they look? What is our threshold?
Well, we're above. We had to go from 1 to 9%. Then the next, if we get accepted again, on to 15, I think.
15.
We're above that, so we're fine there. We have plenty of community commitment, and our committee is listed on the back page there. We've got a lot of people involved to help us. We also have visitors who come and help at times.
Yeah, we keep testing our students at the rate that we're going. We should make that 15%.
But here's the thing about it. The state has quit giving money for the high schools to test the college-ready people. I mean, the career-ready people are used to, so we got another dilemma there. We'll talk about that. Okay, let's go back up to educational attainment.
Before you go, let me just ask you a question.
Okay.
Your skills test. One person, what's the average pay, or what is the cost?
To test.
I mean, go through the training and test.
Are you talking about the work keys?
Yes.
It's around $30 a person now.
It could be as much as 70.
But we're paying. We've been paying for the kids in high school a lot. There are a few to take it because they pay for some, but they'll make their.
You've been paying about half.
Half of them, yes.
Yeah, the career.
If they get their ones educated.
No, wait, I'm sorry. You're paying for the college ready.
Yes.
The state did pay for the career.
Yes, we're paying for the high school kids, yes.
Yeah, I don't know what's going to happen now. I forgot how much they're willing to test or whether they can still test there or not. But we're still kicking it. We've got the online testing started here. And maybe that we'll get some of those high school kids down here. I don't know. But yeah, the court putting the money in for this testing as the main reason for these numbers going up. Because you've paid for all the testing here, which is about half of those, that number, probably 500 of them, that I've tested in the last 3 years. But educational attainment, that's the one thing we didn't make enough improvement to become a work-ready community. And we went from 16.4% of our people having at least an associate degree or above, up to 18.7, we had at least 25%, which is almost impossible to do in a short time. So that's...
Correct me if I'm wrong, but all people are struggling with this one, though, aren't they, pretty much?
Well, not the urban areas, like yeah. Davis County, Bowling Green, it's got universities.
But you're outlining communities.
Your rural areas are having trouble yeah. attaining 25% with their associates or above. And we've discussed that. I think some change is supposed to be coming, aren't they? You've heard yeah. some too about
that. Yeah, I mean, not that it's not a worthwhile goal to have regardless, but as far as the certification program is concerned, they are looking at including industry certifications to that criteria as well, in addition to two-year degrees, realizing that, you know, not all good paying jobs need a two-year degree, and maybe that's not the best benchmark that we're measuring ourselves on.
I would agree with that.
I would too.
Some of these technical jobs, you know, they gotta be trained in them to go on.
We'll take our
land them to a degree, a better job.
Yeah.
Once they learn the trade.
Take our coding boot camp participants that are training over at the Hub right now. You know, they're not going to have a degree when they complete it, but they'll come out making $40,000 and $60,000 a year after, and then up to $80,000, you know, not having a diploma to hang on the wall.
So. Very few two-year degrees, just an associate in science or arts. Just having that is not going to get you a degree. A job is going to see that kind of revenue.
What's going to amount to, they keep requiring that, we can't make it unless something drastic happens. If we got industry in here required, more college educated people, we cross a lot in, we might. But look how long it takes. This only counts for people
25 to 64.
All these high school graduates we got going, say, getting associates. That wouldn't count to get 25 years old.
And this is only about 5 or 6 years, so really we haven't even seen the effects of the kids yet, so now it's just going to start.
Right, so it's not a reasonable objective of right. trying to reach right now. And I hope there's something to be done about that.
It's almost likely geared towards certain
yeah.
communities.
But the other one I want to talk about is soft skills. And soft skills are those skills getting to work all the time. Communicating with co-workers and hard worker, industry tells us that's the number one call need right now. Not just personnel, but personnel with solid skills that'll work and be there on time and do a good job when they get there. We had to improve solid skills program here in the county, so the approach we took was to use the JA, Junior Achievement Program, and try to get as many seniors trained. In fact, we got all the seniors last year with the Junior Achievement Career Success Program, and we're going to do that again this year. That will give us 200 and some seniors trained, which was, 1 year we had 40, we got slow start, and then we got it up to 60, and then we let all the seniors last year, all this year, and but that comes at a cost. The Junior Achievement Career Success or any computer achievement has materials and personnel, and that comes at a cost. And we have a couple of the people that work out of Owensboro with computer achievement, Christy Harrison and Don here with us, was going to be talking to you this morning about that. But soft skills, we're okay there because we have been improving. We need to extend that on down into elementary, middle school. And I might say that a lot of these things start at home too. A lot of these soft skills and expectations of education, educational attainment need to start at home and grow from there. This time I'm going to let Christy and Dan come up. They have been good to us about coming over to train us and bringing our materials and helping with the high school.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you all for letting Junior Achievement of Ohio County be here this evening with you all. My name is Christy Harrison. Like Kenny said, I'm the new staff person devoted to Ohio County. It's one of my counties that I cover, so we're excited about that expansion in our office. We'd just like to take a couple minutes to talk to you about where JA is in Ohio County. Kenny mentioned we've been in the high school serving about 200 students and where we want to go and the new requests that we have for expansion there. Dan Douglas, our president of Junior Achievement, is here with us tonight. I'm going to let him share about our mission briefly.
Judge,
or however long he wants to talk.
Judge, managers, thanks for the brief amount of time that we'll take today. We've been serving Ohio County Schools, great partnership with Scott Lewis and fine folks there in the school system for about 5 years. By our count, we worked with over 1,000 high school students, specifically as Kenny talked about, through that soft skills program, or what they're now calling essential skills at the state level. Teamwork, work ethic, communication, problem solving, etc. Many of the things that local manufacturers, local employers are citing as deficient in the current workforce. We're directly impacting and supporting your work-ready credentialing through that program that single-handedly kind of helps that soft skills attainment that you need. Indirectly, we're also helping with educational attainment of encouraging students to look beyond high school to certificate programs, two-year degree, 4 years degrees, and certainly also impacting the high school graduation rate. So really three different components of Work Ready. Junior Achievement is proud to partner with your community to kind of help along those lines. Beyond the high school soft skills program and working with Scott or with the school system and talking with the principal at the middle school, we would like to, and they have requested, for us to drive our programs down to the middle school level as well, which would about double the amount of students served here in Ohio County. Specifically, that middle school program would be a career exploration, financial literacy program. We've seen a lot of national data that if you wait to empower and change kids' attitudes about life after high school, that if you wait till high school, you've really waited too long, that largely their attitudes and beliefs of what they can do after high school has already been made by the time they get there. So to have an intervention program at the critical middle grades level that will steer them in the right direction, talk about career opportunities with some post-secondary education, can be critical to what Kenny's talked about tonight of increasing that educational attainment figure. So we would like to do that. We're prepared to do that. We would love to have some help with you all. Thankful of the past support that you all have given to Junior Achievement. I think the last came in 2015, $1,500. So we would love to continue to see you all make that investment in your own future workforce and work-ready credentialing by helping support those JA programs that we're delivering to your local students. We've got one of the lowest costs in the United States at $20 a student. So it's real easy for you all to do the math. If we serve about 500 students this school year at the middle grades and high school level, that's about $10,000 in program costs that we have. I don't know if y'all would be open to it, but we're prepared to go into the private sector here and find about a $4 to $1 match if you all would be willing to invest $2,500 in that expansion of JA programs as part of this overall economic development partnership. And I'll turn it back over to Christy. I appreciate your time. I appreciate the opportunity to serve your students.
Well, I think you kind of wrapped it up, Dan. We just wanted to say a very sincere thank you. That $1,500 donation that you all made 2 years ago was very significant in our $5,000 budget at that time when we were serving those 10 classrooms. So with the expansion of another 10 classrooms at the middle school, Chase and Kenny and I just met along with our program team members at JA, and we're just kind of scratching our heads trying to figure out where we're going to get this funding. We know the need is there. We know the want from the school system is there to empower the youth. It's just going out and finding those dollars. So we'll leave it up to you all. Kenny,
Judge, if there's anything formal that we would need to do, we would be happy to do that.
Okay. We'll let Kenny get back with you.
Okay. I know you guys are about like our businesses. You're hit often for funds. And I know you can't fulfill all of them, but I will say this is one of the most important that I have come for you for. Thank you.
Question? Thank you.
Appreciate that. I did want to make one comment. Kenny does give that work keys test. It saves us a lot of getting that done. And most likely, if he didn't do it, we probably would not have nearly the successes with that increase in those numbers we've had not been for him giving it. So I really appreciate that. I have a late thing from the Sheriff's Department. He turned in his financial statement on tax collections statement on the sand and gravel and the oil property. And we're just going to file it with the minutes of this meeting. And all I need is a motion to acknowledge that we received these two sheets of paper from the Sheriff's. Okay. Motion to Sam, second by Joe for the sand and gravel property tax settlement. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Motion carried. Now I need one for the oil property.
I'll make motion.
Motion by Joe Barnes.
I'll second this one.
Second by Jason Bullock. Any discussion? None. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. That motion carried. Here they are, and include them with the minutes. Next up is committee reports. Do we have any committee report? I'm going to read one the airport just gave me. We're not ready to ask for anything or really report other than their Jet A tank is down at the airport. Marty's here. He's working hard on trying to get that back up and running. We still have significant aircraft fuel sales, but we don't have jet right now. The repairs on the tank we have now, we're going to need a total of about $100,000, which he's working on trying to get the money to do it with. And we'll keep the court informed on this. Any other committee reports? Have any committees met since we were here last? If none, we're ready for the magistrate's comments and requests. Sam?
I have none, Judge. Thank you.
Jason?
No, thank you.
Joe?
I've got a couple on that junior achievement. I mean, I'd be willing to throw in some discretionary money on that. It sounds like they can do 4-to-1 match in the private sector. That would be a
what
advantageous for us.
And I told you, I will.
What amount do you propose?
Well, I could do 500 at that would work for everybody else. I mean,
I could too. So
I'll do fine.
Yep. I'll do that.
That's four. That's 2,000 right there, right? If we've done the math correctly. You too. So Larry, Kim. So that's $2,500.
That's $2,500.
That's $2,500. So. And is authorized to write that check.
I guess you want me to check with Larry Morphew. That's the same.
Why don't you do that, please?
Well, we did 500 five ways.
He can get 500.
He does 500, be 3,000. That would really.
that would really fix them up. They'd really be tickled with that. And like she said, the expenses have gone up.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Joe. What else you got?
Just wanted to make a mention on the ferry. I've seen it made to the paper, but anyway, the ferry, they got all the ramp approaches done, and actually Butler County, I've seen where they have posted this on the online somewhere about all our help, and you know, it looks really good down there. I know you got down there and got to see it.
We, Larry Morphew and I got to ride it the first day of Stackhouse.
They redid those ferry ramp approaches, and you know, everybody's not dragging their car bumpers off and trying to enter and exit the ferry down there. Really nice. And then the only other thing is just let's all think about Larry's family. I know they had a loss in the family, and that's why he's not here tonight. Most people saw it on the news, but the state trooper that was killed in Texas is Rita's cousin, and he was killed in while he was on duty. So anyway, it's just to think about them tonight.
Yes. And I want to brag on Joe a little bit. He thought this would never happen, but I'm going to brag on him. I could on several things. I was just kidding. But he helped very much on that. He did the engineering portion of the approaches on the ferry ramps, and it saved a lot of money and made it possible to happen, which we probably could not have done it if he hadn't done that. So I want to commend him on that. And I would also challenge every one of you to go down the ferry, check it out, and ride it. It's a great thing to have. And maybe the few more improvements we can do again. But it's a pretty area down there. There's a building, there's a place to park, you can stop and go in, there's bathrooms. And it's a neat little trip. Even if you don't need to go to Butler or Muhlenberg County, it would be worth going over there and riding the ferry anyway.
I would like to get that little area down there by the locks.
Yes.
Dressed up a little bit nicer, some gravel on it for the, there's a lot of people go down there and fish.
Yes.
And that's something I'd like to look a little bit more into in our county, any way we can aid in the hunting and fishing, because we get a lot of tourism to this county. Actually, we just had one of the biggest tourism booms in the county in November because the deer hunting. I don't even know what the number would be that comes from out of state for the deer hunting down there, and fishing wildlife area we got. It's such a big, large area, and it's a big appeal for people.
But what he's talking about, we own a piece of property behind the, already, we already own some behind the building where the ferry operates out of. But what I think he's talking about, very soon, the Corps of Engineers is going to turn over the land to us where the old lockmaster's quarters were and all that. He's talking about we can put a little parking lot down there, and Fish and Wildlife will put us in a boat ramp there, and we'll have a good access on the river for fishing. And all we'll have to do is extend the road maybe 200 feet and gravel it. Yeah, a little parking area. So, since we get in our name, we'll probably want to take in the road too. For that 200 or 300 feet.
And I can't take all the credit for that engineering done. Chad Tyree from Butler County, he's in the same kind of line of work I do, and he helped a lot on the computer end of it. So
good deal. Anything else?
No.
Larry?
Yes, just one item, Judge. I want to revisit the administrative code that we discussed last week, and I want to entertain a motion to approve the new revisions of the administrative code. This not only includes one of the changes that was made in it, was of course with the GEDs, but another provision in it was that we've got a growing, aging population out of the road department. There's going to be several over the year, next few years retiring, but they'd like to come back to work maybe as part-time for the county. And what I'd like to see changed is they stay at the same rate of pay as when they quit, when they come back to work part-time. So I entertain that motion.
I'll second.
Okay. On the
for discussion, we'd like to add that, you know, you did say same amount of pay when they come back is when they quit, if they retire, right? Now they just quit, we're not going to hire back at that same rate, right?
Yeah, the provision says, Sam, that if they retire in good faith or whatever, they maybe just want to work part-time, some of them may not want to work any. But if they do, they'd be a valuable resource to the the county to have them back to work during, especially during summertime.
Well, what he's talking about too, that the second part there I have no problem with, but it's not requiring a GED. I do because of some things that's developed and we've learned. We're trying to become work ready. If we're asking our community to become work ready, we need to set the example as county. At the road department, we really have a young man, which we really do want to bring into it, that doesn't have it. He's very close to getting it, and we are working with him to help him. I met with him today with Keith present. I did the talking, told him what he needed to do. Personal help for me and Jason, as well as professional help from Adult Ed and the Career Center. We feel that particular issue is going to be resolved very quickly, and we're working on it. And we met with him today and told him the plan we had for him. But I just really don't want to lower our standards on that. If this motion came back just to include the thing for our retirees to come back as seasonal or temporary, I would have no problem with that. But that's my part of the discussion.
Can we do one piece at a time?
That's an amendment he wrote for the GED, which requires a first and second reading.
No, I'm saying can we break each section of this first section and second, vote on a change for the first section.
Reading with only one amendment.
The motion stands as it is, Jason. It has a second. After discussion, we'll vote.
This will be the first reading. Okay.
Barnes?
Yes.
Johnston?
No.
Cam?
Yes.
Small?
Yes.
Bullock?
No.
I believe this being a ordinance has to have a majority of the court. I believe we said that during when we was looking at this alcohol tax thing. I believe we learned that it took, on a ordinance amendment, it took a majority of the court, even if you had a majority of those present. So I would be glad to change this ruling if it's proven wrong, but as of now, I'm gonna say that motion failed. Anything else, Larry?
Yeah, I would like to ask our county attorney to look at that and report to the court that if you have five individuals that make a decision on the court, have a particular night, see if Judge Johnson is correct in his assumption that you have to have all six members here to for it to pass on an ordinance. I've been on the court several years and I've never heard of that.
Well, so four
votes.
Take four votes, so.
That's what I'm saying. I just want a clarification.
That'd be fine. And I'll tell you, when we visited this last, is when we were on that alcohol tax deal. It's the last time this came up.
Let Justin look into it.
Sure, absolutely.
Look into it, Justin.
And it's not that I'm against the work ready program or anything like that, but this gentleman's an asset to our community, asset to our road department. He's been there, he works every day. Keith can attest to this, that he's there every day to work. He's knowledgeable in CDL license and tanker license. And this is, as again, it's not against any work-ready program or anything like that. I just think experience in anything has to count. Some people, when they get out of high school, they go off to college, which is fine, and improve their academics and nothing all that. But then some people have to go to work. And when they go to work, they learn valuable experience, whatever the case may be. And that's, I'm not trying to be negative, I'm just trying to help help our road department to have good, experienced people that continue to work if they need to do.
Yeah. You are right, Larry, on that particular job. You know, sometimes I think some of the other criteria that he's obtained over time, like CDLs and tanker license and everything, applies a little bit heavier for that particular job than necessarily the GED, but.
We might look into that, but with this particular case that we're looking at, we're going to have that resolved. He's going to be getting GED, and he'll be hired within 2 months.
And I want to be hired, but I don't want to lower the standard. And I think we're working with him. I've called, made some I've talked to Keith. And the thing about it is, the state road department requires one too. So even with, you know, that's something they require too. It's, I just hate to think that with our work ready, we're not setting the example. We're asking somebody to do something and we're going backwards. Listen, I went to the guy, I had the job. We called some people and we talked about him. He's still got time till January to get his, and we're working with him. I made a phone call, the guy said he'll work with him once a week down there, and as far as the pay, that we've kind of worked on that. I want him to have the job, but I want him, I think this way it's helping him too, and I think he'll be glad when he gets it.
We visited him today, and Jason and I have offered him some financial help on it, and we've figured out ways that he can get this thing taken while he's still in the, he's still in the workforce. And he should have it. He likes 1 point passing math.
I can understand y'all's thoughts in this matter, but you penalize an individual because he's got work experience, and that's the part of it I just quite frankly don't understand. That you penalize the guy because he has 10 years. I don't know how old the gentleman is, Keith, but he does have a tremendous amount of experience, my understanding. And we as a court, and you know the irony of it is, if we have to get down there. Of all of us sitting up here, with the exception of the county attorney, we don't have to have GED. So, what are we saying, guys?
And the only other question I would have on this situation, since we had a majority for tonight, and if it does take, if that's all it takes to change it,
right.
Are we going to go ahead and proceed on this, Judge? And
for a second reading, yes.
Do we have to have second readings? Is that what we have to have?
Well, and the thing about it, the young man still has, he has, still has time left on the season.
I didn't know if we found out that this would be true, that this would change, Judge, do we need to go ahead and make a motion to, it will change the thing to go ahead and hire him.
Well, we have to have a second reading.
We have to have a second reading. Yeah, I didn't know that.
It should be on the December 12th meeting, but we need 2 weeks to advertise, so we need to find out sooner than later.
Well, yeah, Justin will find out for sure about that, but it just came up in the, when we was talking at the alcohol tax, and Sam and I were in a training, and the source of that training is what told us that. If it's wrong, we'll say that that first reading passed.
Judge, actually, since you brought that up on the alcohol, we did get a reading back from the Attorney General that we could not do that, so can... do we need to go ahead and just cancel that motion we had made? And
well, it was pending on the election.
It was pending.
Well, I didn't know if
it was void. Yeah.
The ordinance indicated in it that it was void if for some reason the Attorney General felt
that. Okay, I didn't know it'd be like there'd be a motion out there hanging over prior courts coming behind us. That
we could put something clarification that was null and void when, because the Attorney General said we couldn't do it.
Okay.
Probably maybe should attach something to those memories.
Yeah, I wouldn't want any old business to come up on it. Several years down the road, it'd be an issue.
In the ordinance as well.
Okay. That's all I have, Judge.
Okay. Anybody in the public have anything for the good of the body? Being none, thank everybody for coming. And again, we'll say we'll think about Larry Morphew and his family. And what they're going through, and with that, I call this meeting adjourned.